In just 15 minutes, we will build a Python dashboard and deploy it to the internet for free. The dashboard will include metric cards to show the total sales and the difference compared to the previous year. Below that, we will add a filter to view the sales for a specific city and display the sales result by the month and also by categories. We will also include a toggle button to show the sales for the previous year. The data for this dashboard comes from a CSV file, but you can easily use an Excel file or even an SQL database. To create this dashboard, we will use the Python library with Streamlit, which allows you to build web applications entirely in Python. There is no need to learn HTML, CSS, or JavaScript. For cleaning and analyzing the data, we will use Pandas, and I will share some of my favorite Pandas tips along the way. As a bonus, we will deploy the web application for free so anyone on the internet can access it. So, without further ado, let us dive in.
First things first, we need to install Streamlit. You can do that by running pip install Streamlit in your command prompt or terminal. Additionally, since we will be working with data, we will also need Pandas. You can install it the same way using pip install pandas. Once that is done, I will open a new Python file. I'm calling it streamlit_app.py. In this file, I will import the libraries by adding the lines import streamlit as st and also import pandas as pd. Next, let's create a very simple app to make sure everything is set up correctly. First, I will give our app a title and icon. For the icon, you can even use emojis. If you're on Windows, you can open the emoji picker by pressing the Windows key and period. I'm going to pick the chart emoji for this example. For the body of the page, I will just add a simple title that says Sales Dashboard. Alright, and that's it for now. Before going further, let's test it out. Back in the terminal, I will run the app by typing streamlit run followed by the name of the Python file. In my case, that would be streamlit_app.py. Just make sure you're in the same directory as your Python file before running this command. Alright, and when I press enter, my default browser will open and I will see the app displayed. Here on the page now, we will see the icon, the title, and also the content we added. In your case, you might actually see a white page with black text. That's because the default theme is light. I have set my system to dark mode, so my app appears with a dark background. But if you want, you can change the appearance in the Streamlit settings. Alright, now that the app is running, I will place the app and my code side by side so that we can easily see any changes we make. Next, I want to load the dataset we will be analyzing. For this, I will create a small configuration section at the top of the script. Here, I will insert the link to the dataset. In my case, it's a CSV file that I uploaded to GitHub. To load the dataset, I will use Pandas. Once the data is stored in the Pandas data frame, we can display it in our app using st.dataframe. When I save the script and refresh the app, I will see the data right here in the browser. In this dataset, I've got the sales for fictional stores in Tokyo, Yokohama, and Osaka. Now, before we dive deeper, I like to clean and format the data in a separate Jupyter notebook first. This helps me to get a clearer understanding of the dataset. Once that is done, I will copy the relevant code from the Jupyter notebook and implement it in our Streamlit application. By the way, I will also upload the Jupyter notebook to my GitHub repository, and you will find the download link in the description box below. So, to get started, let's first load the dataset, just like we did in Streamlit. Once we have the dataset loaded, I will display the first three rows to show what we are working with. Alright, so here's the data. Now, in the final application, I want to visualize the sales by city, by product category, and also by month. But as for now, we only have one column for the sales date. So in the next step, I will create separate columns for the month and the year. But before we do that, let's take a quick look at the current data types in the dataset. For that, I will use the info method from Pandas. So this is helpful to understand the structure of the dataset and check for any issues like missing data or incorrect data types. Looking at the output here, we can see that we don't have any missing values, which is great. However, the date of sales column is currently an object data type. This means it's being treated as a plain text rather than an actual date. To fix this, we will need to convert it into a datetime object. And we can do that using the toDateTime method. Once I apply the transformation, you can see that the date of sales column is now a proper datetime object. This is great because it allows us to easily extract the month and the year from it. So next, I will create a new column for the month based on the sales date, and I will also do the same for the year. When I run this, you will see the two new columns added to the dataset. One for the month and one for the year. So far, so good. Now, the next step is optional. It really depends on your preference, but I personally like changing pandas methods. Currently, we have done our transformations in three different steps. First, converting the date to a datetime object, then extracting the month, and then finally the year. But we can actually do all of this in one single line using the assign method, which lets you add or modify multiple columns at once. And the code is pretty much the same, but this time we will be using the lambda function. And if you want to learn more about pandas changing and why you also might want to use it, then you can also check out another video on my channel. I will leave a link to that video also in the description box below. Alright, so as I said, the output is still the same. When I run this, we will see the two new columns just like before. Alright, and with that, let us move on to our first analysis. So I want to calculate the total sales by city for any given year. At the top of the code, I have defined the year as a variable. And to group the sales, I will use the pandas group by method. In this case, I want to group the sales by city and year, and then sum up the sales amounts. When I run this, we get a nice table showing the total sales for each city by year. And to make it a bit easier to extract the data later on, I will use the unstack method to reshape the data frame so that the years appear as a separate columns. After running this, the data frame will look like this. Now I also want to add a column that shows the year-over-year percentage change. Just like before, I will use the assign method to create a new column. In this column, I will calculate the percentage change. Once that is done, you can see the final data frame. So, for example, it shows that in Osaka, we saw a 5.5 increase in sales in 2023 compared to the previous year. And now from this data frame, we can also filter it further for any specific city using the log method. For example, if we want a sales revenue for Tokyo in 2023, we just need to specify the city and the year. And we can do the same also for the percentage change. Alright, and lastly, to make it more readable, I've also formatted the output using an s-string, so it shows up as a clean, nicely worded sentence. Alright, and now we are ready to display these insights into our dashboard. So, back in the code, the first thing I will do is to load the data and apply the necessary transformations. For that, I will create a dedicated function. Instead of directly using now pd.readcsv, I will call this function and pass in the data URL. Now, when I save the script and refresh our application, we will see our data. But this time, the two additional columns we created earlier, so the month and the year, are also included. As I mentioned before, I actually prefer using the pandas changing method for cleaner code. So I will replace the current implementation with that. But if you prefer the other method, that's totally fine. Both approaches give the same result. So, once I save the changes and reload the page, you will see that the data is still the same. The only important thing here is that you ensure that the data loading and transformation steps are handled inside a dedicated function. Why, you may ask? Well, Streamlit runs your code from top to bottom every time you interact with the application. For example, if you click a button or change a filter, Streamlit will rerun the entire script. But by keeping this part in a function and adding the cache data decorator to it, the data will be only loaded once instead of loading the data again and again whenever the user interacts with your application. So, think of the cache decorator as a short-term memory function for your application. Once the data is cached, it won't reload. Alright, and with that, let us move on to displaying the total sales amount for the different cities at the top of the application. And we actually already created the necessary data frame back in the Jupyter notebook, so I will simply reuse that code. When I display the data, this is what it looks like. And just like before, I will take out the hard-coded year, so 2023, and replace it with a variable named year. And I will define this variable in our config section right above our data URL. Now, instead of displaying the data frame as a table, I want to create metric cards. This will show the key metrics for each city in a more visually appealing way. Eventually, I want to have three cards, one for each city, and display all of them in a single row. To do this, I will create three columns, a left, middle, and right column using Streamlit's columns element. Then I will use a width block to insert a metric card inside each column. For now, I will use some dummy data to demonstrate how it looks. So each metric card will have a label, so the city name, a value, so the total sales amount, and a delta, so the change compared to the previous year. Next, instead of hard-coding these values, I will use a log method from pandas to dynamically pull in the data, just like we did in the Jupyter notebook. But before doing that, I will define another variable at the top of the config section, which is our list of cities, because we will use this list for the metric cards and later also for the filter section. With our city list ready, I will insert the metric cards into each column. So as I said, the label will be the city name from our list, the value will be fetched using the log method, and the delta will show the year-over-year percentage change. Now, if you don't want to repeat the code for each city three times, you could also use a loop. For example, you could use a numeral rate to loop through the cities and dynamically generate the metrics for each one. But to keep things simple here, I've just written out the three columns manually. And with that done, I can now actually delete the data frame, because now we have our metric cards. Next, below all these numbers, I want to give the users more ways to explore the data. For that, I will use some selection fields. And in Streamlit, this is actually super easy to set up. First, I will add a drop-down menu or select box where the users can choose a specific city. The available options will be the list of cities we defined earlier. Whatever the user selects will be stored in a variable called selected city. Additionally, I will also add a toggle button to let the user switch between the years. Now, the toggle button returns a Boolean value, so true or false. So if the user toggles on show previous year, I will subtract 1 from the current year variable. Otherwise, I will default to the current year, so in this case 2023. Alright, so after making our selection, I want to show two types of analysis. One that displays the sales by month, and another one that shows the sales by category. For this, I will use a tabs element in Streamlit. Just like with the columns, we can use a with block to define the content inside each tab. For now, I will insert some dummy text to demonstrate how it works. So here on my page, you can see that we can switch between the tabs. Okay, and now instead of the dummy text, let's actually add the real charts. For that, let me switch back to the Jupyter notebook. So in our Streamlit app, we are going to use two filter values, the selected city from the drop-down menu and also the year from the toggle button. To filter our dataset based on these values, we will use the query method in Pandas. It is actually pretty simple to use. You just define the columns you want to filter and then specify the filter criteria. In this case, I want to filter the city column by the selected city. And to use a variable inside the query method, we just need an @ symbol before the variable name. And you are not limited to just one filter. You can include as many filters as you want. So I will also filter the dataset by the selected year. Once I run this, we can see the filtered data. So, for example here, we can only see the sales now for Tokyo in 2023. Next, let us group this filter dataset. For the first analysis, I want to group the data by month and then calculate the total sales. So when I execute this, Pandas will return the result. Now you will notice that the output looks a little bit different. That's because by default it returns a Pandas series. And you can confirm this by checking the type. If you want the output as a data frame, you can set sindex to false. Once I do that, the month becomes a column instead of an index, and now we also have our Pandas data frame. Additionally, I have set dropNA to false. By default, it is set to true, but I recommend switching it to false, especially if you have null values in your dataset. I actually made a dedicated video explaining why this matters, so I definitely recommend checking out that video. And you guessed it already, I will leave the link to that video also in the description box below. Alright, now that we have the data grouped by month, let's switch back to our Streamlit application. So here I will just paste in the code we just wrote. The only thing left is to add the chart. And Streamlit makes this super easy. We just use the bar chart function and pass in the filter dataset. And that's it. Now we have a bar chart that shows the sales by month. And I will do the same for the category tab. The only difference here is that I group the data by the product category instead of the month. Then I will pass in the group data into another bar chart just like before. Once I've done that, I will save the code and reload our application. Alright, and there we have it, our fully functional dashboard. So I can select a city, choose a year, and then switch between the tabs to view the sales by month or by product category. Now the only thing that bothers me a bit is the default Streamlit branding. At the top, we've got a colorful header and also the hamburger icon. While these things are useful during development, so the hamburger icon for example, I want the app to look a little bit cleaner. So to hide these elements, we can tweak the CSS a little bit. For that I wrote a small snippet of HTML and CSS to remove the branding. To apply it I will use Streamlit's markdown element and set allowHTML to true. And now when I go back to the app and reload it, we will see it looks much cleaner now. So we don't have the colorful header anymore and also the hamburger icon is gone. Okay guys, and that's pretty much it. Now the final step is to deploy this application to the internet, because right now it's running locally on your machine. To deploy it, the first thing we will do is to upload this code to GitHub. And for that I will be using VS Code. So in VS Code I will navigate to the source control section, initialize a new repository and commit my code. Then I will publish this branch to a public repository. Now since we've also used an additional package, so Pandas, we need to let the server know which packages it needs to install. For this we will create a requirements.txt file. And this is just a normal text file. So let me quickly create the file and then in this file write down the packages we used. So in our case it's Streamlit and also Pandas. Once that is done I will go back to the source control section, commit the changes and then publish them to the repository. And with that in place we are now ready to deploy our app to the Streamlit community cloud. For that head over to streamlit.io/cloud and create a free account if you haven't already. Once you are logged in, click on Create App. Next, select GitHub and choose the repository we just created. Down here, you can also adjust the app's URL if you would like. For example, I will name mine Japan-Sales-Dashboard. Now, deploying the application might take a minute, but once it's done, your sales dashboard will be live on the internet. Okay guys, and there you have it, your data app created with just a few lines of Python code. And if you want to learn more about Streamlit, be sure to check out my other videos here on YouTube. And in the future, I'm actually also planning to create a full Streamlit course where we will build a more advanced application. If that sounds interesting to you, you can sign up for the waiting list on my website. The link is in the description box below. And as always, thanks for watching and I will see you in the next video.